Welcome back to Bash Bros in episode 78 of Notorious Pro Wrestling, the TAW Let's Play series where we find out what exactly would happen if Conor McGregor started his own wrestling promotion. It's the go-home show for Braveheart in November. So, it's been a while since you guys have been with us. The last time you guys were here was October week 1. So it's been a month and 2 weeks since you have been here. The last time you guys were with us was a Rev Pro episode, where we saw the debut of a new faction, the Notorious, down in Rev Pro, and also the crowning of new tag team champions. Yes, Aussie Open, double champs, Rev Pro tag champs, and Notorious Pro Wrestling tag champs. So let's... Holy shit. Let's cover what you've missed since you've last been here. This is going to be a long segment. So the last Notorious show you saw would have been the Banjax pay-per-view. So let's take it from the Fallout show for that pay-per-view. We had Jay demand a title shot since he beat Chris Hero at Banjax. And he agreed, and then Penta came out and laid out Jay Lethal. Dynasty and the NIC then went on to beat Aussie Open and Kings of the North, and post-match Aussie Open and Kings of the North got a little bit shovey-shovey, argy-bargy, just to continue that feud on. Angelina Love was disgusted Vicky flirted with Ace, but Ace, let's be honest, sexy boy. What? But Ace says he can't blame her, and that pissed off Angelina. Rhea O'Reilly then questions Martina as to why she didn't help her during the beatdown from Crazy Mary Dobson, and that if she isn't going to help her, stay out of her way. And in the main event, we had the Lucha Bros defeat Grizzle Young Vets, and then afterwards, to send a message to the champ, Jay Lethal laid out his brother Phoenix. All in all, a 74 rated show. Next up, from Wales, we had the British Wrestling MC win a squash match. Afterwards though, Nick Aldis came out and taunted Kamen, who got the win over him at the pay-per-view, leading to the Grizzled Young Vets and Easton Reese attacking British Wrestling MC and siding with Nick Aldis. Later on in the night, Light Ghost Jim defeated the Filthy Generation when Jonathan Gresham stopped Stevie Boy from interfering on Filthy Gen's behalf, continuing the storyline of will he partner back up with Light Ghost Jim, or what's going to happen there? We just don't know. After that then, we had Maki Ito and Riho defeat Tessa Blanchard and Zia Brookside, and post-match Tessa slaps the absolute shit out of Zia for losing. And in the main event then, Pac defeated Kenny Williams, and post-match Connor tells Pac that he is not going to allow a psychotic son of a bitch like him ruin the company he has worked so hard to build. And the match is set for the pay-per-view, Conor McGregor versus Pac. 72 rated show for that week. Moving on to October week 2's Wanted, coming from the Midlands. In a backstage angle, Martina stops Rhea from challenging Crazy Mary Dobson. Jake the Snake then twists the situation, and we get Rhea versus Martina later that night. And in that match, Martina went on to beat Rhea O'Reilly. Post-match, Crazy Mary Dobson comes out and beats down both women, then allowing Rhea to have her rematch at the pay-per-view. In our next match then, Aussie Open defeated Kings of the North, but afterwards Epitaph attacked both teams. Epitaph, of course, have been contenders for the tag titles, but also twisting the situation between Aussie Open and Kings of the North so that they end up pitting against each other. And in our main event, Jay Lethal defeated Rey Fénix. Afterwards, Jay Lethal tried to rip off Fénix's mask, but Penta made the save. 69 rated show. And then the go-home show for the Fuck What They Think pay-per-view. In week 3 of October, in six-man action, the British Wrestling Embassy defeat Easton Reese and the Grizzled Young Vets after Reese accidentally spears Zach Gibson. And later on that night, Aldous reminds Reese that he's a failure and needs to fall in line after Reese gets yappity that he doesn't remember signing up to be a stooge. In a backstage angle then, Conor McGregor asks Chris Hero if he will help him prepare for Pac, but he already has a match tonight, but has the perfect opponent in mind to get Conor ready for the Bastard Pack at the pay-per-view. Then later that night, Tessa Blanchard defeated Riho and tried to injure her post-match, but Maiko Satomura and Maki Ito make the save. But funnily enough, Dynasty don't make the save to help Tessa after she had been a little bit of a bitch to them for a couple of weeks. And in the main event, Conor McGregor defeated Jonathan Gresham in a fucking great match. And then post-match, Pac and Conor get into it, and just before agents break them apart, Conor is able to get a chokehold on Pac, just to give that idea that holy shit, Conor might actually be able to do this. And then the Fuck What They Think pay-per-view itself, held on Sunday, week 3. Crazy Mary Dobson defeated Rhea O'Reilly by targeting her injuries previously, but in the post-match angle, Martina finally overcomes her fear of Crazy Mary Dobson and makes the save, as Mary was going to injure Rhea further. And in the marquee match of the night, Pac was able to defeat Conor McGregor in a, like, dude, it was 78. That's sick. That's so good. And in the next match, Maki Ito was able to defeat Tessa Blanchard to retain the NPW Women's Championship. Afterwards, she called out Mako Satomura and said it would be an honor to defend her title against her mentor. Maiko agrees, but says up until their next match, she is going to treat Maki as an enemy and sucker punches her in the middle of the ring. Next up, in a triple threat tag match, Aussie Open were able to defend their NPW tag titles against Kings of the North and the NIC. Post-match, Oisin Delaney hits Mark Davies with a chair and tosses it to Damian Corbin. Kyle sees this and thinks that Corbin has been the one that assaulted Davies, and they get into a massive brawl. And finally, in our main event, Pentagon Jr. defeated Jay Lethal to retain his NPW Pentagon defeated Jay Lethal to retain his NPW Heavyweight Championship. 73, sure waiting for that. And in the Fallout show for the pay-per-view then, Martina is able to defeat Crazy Mary Dobson when Rhea O'Reilly interferes on her behalf. And then in a backstage segment, Angelina Love and Vicky Haskins go up to Ace and Mark, saying that they've realised that the men are the problem, and have spoken to Conor McGregor via telephone, and he has booked them in a tag match for tonight. And in that tag match, Ace Austin and Mark Haskins are able to defeat the Grizzly Young Vets, again after a botched interference from Easton Reese. Then via satellite chat, isn't that what they call it in WWE? Conor announces the return of the Braveheart Battle Royal at the Braveheart pay-per-view later this month. Then in a one-on-one match, Damian Corbin and Mark Davies went to a no contest when Epitaph interfered halfway through the match and attacked both teams. Eddie Dennis then laughed at how easy it had been to manipulate both Kings of the North and Aussie Open. In a backstage promo, Jen tries to get a word with Pac, however Jake the Snake Robert interrupts and says he wants a word with him off screen. And in the main event, Pac defeats Jay Lethal to become the number one contender for the NPW Championship. 74 rated show that week. Then in November, week 1's Wanted, Aussie Open defeated Like Coast Jim, but both teams brawl until Jonathan Gresham comes out and screams at them to sort their shit out, or else both teams can lose his number. Next up, in a backstage promo, Aldous absolutely goes apeshit at Reese for costing the Grizzled Young Vets their match last week, and has set him in a handicap match later tonight against the Grizzled Young Vets. In the next match, Maiko Satomura defeated Riho in particularly brutal fashion, causing Maki to come out and check on her partner. During this though, Maiko starts slapping the crap out of Maki, telling her to do something about it, but she doesn't. Backstage then, Jake proposes a tag match between Sonico and his new protege, Pac, against Rey and his former protege, Penta. During this, Sonico just stares daggers at Rey Fenix, setting up that kind of feud that, you know, Penta and Sonico used to be very close and chummy, and now that then they kind of had their massive blowout, and now Rey's there and there's like that little bit of jealousy from Sonico now. And Grizzled Young Vets went on to defeat Ace and Reese in a handicap match, because of course they would. And in the main event, Sonico and Pac defeated the Lucha Brothers. 72 rated show. And just last week, week 2, after Martina and Rhea win their squash match, Jake comes out and says Crazy Mary Dobson challenges Martina to a hardcore match at the pay-per-view, to which Martina says she will do it because she's no longer scared, but Jake says she should be. Ace and Mark win their squash match later that night, and afterwards Ace looks like he's going to hit Mark Haskins with his cane, but stops himself and offers the handshake instead. And a number one contenders match for the tag titles, Kings of the North overcome the NIC when Aussie Open attack Eddie Dennis at ringside. In a backstage promo then, Pentagon and Rey Fénix remind Pac that the Death Triangle isn't a thing in Notorious Pro Wrestling, and they're going to come at him with everything they have. Then in the main event, Pac defeats Rey Fénix in a hell of a match, 77, it was a good match. Sonico then comes to ringside and attacks Rey Fénix and has to be forcibly removed from his vicious assault. And that is all the shows, there's a lot of them, you have missed out on since you've last been here. But we're not done yet, as we have to cover all the news, and there is a lot of news too. Holy shit. Let's start off with the big dogs. Let's start off with WWE. They have been hiring. WWE have rehired Matt Cardona. Yes. Zack Ryder back in the dub. Oh, I actually do foresee this happening in real life. I'll not lie. So yes, Matt Cardona, Zack Ryder back in WWE. But it didn't just stop with previous talent. No, WWE signed Wardlow. So he was released from AEW back in March of last year. So pretty much not long after Wardlow was released. And he did the rounds. And Wardlow did the rounds after he was released. He worked for MLW. He worked for Impact. And with our tradition of renaming people who go to WWE, because that's what would happen in real life, he is now called Ripper. Yeah, it is funny how crap the name generator is, but it's very dead on. Like, that is exactly how WWE would name him. Another named hired by WWE is Chris Bay. Currently working for Impact and Black Label Pro, and was also a part of New Japan, now hired by the Big Dub, and he is now called Rio Williams. But the WWE haven't just been signing people, they have been letting people go too. Bobby Lashley, contract expired. He hasn't signed with anyone just yet. I imagine it's probably his age that the AI WWE released him for. Maybe charisma too, depending what their hiring rules are. But yes, Bobby Lashley, now a free agent. Another name that is soon to be released, but hasn't actually officially left yet, Cesaro. His contract was expiring with WWE, and we have signed him. So whenever he leaves there, he'll be joining us. Why would I not? He is a fantastic in-ring competitor. He is European. I think he will be possibly the greatest NPW champion yet, so cannot wait to have him in our company. I won't go into massive details about all of these, but we had a bunch of people whose contracts were expiring, and we've re-signed them all. So very quickly, Jody Fleish, Easton Reese, Stevie Boy Smith, Xavier, Stevie Boy, Damian Corbin, Bonesaw, Aspen Faith, Curtis Axel, Sean Waltman on color commentary, Grado, yes Grado, I have plans for him after the Grado Desperation angle, Scott Bell for referees, all our referees, Andy Coyne on the commentary desk, and Will Hobbs. Speaking of contracts, Naomi, I didn't even know she had left WWE, I'm not sure if we covered it, but Impact hired her. And can I just say, I know, like, you know, art imitating real life here with Naomi leaving and possibly going to Impact, but I'm going to say it, Impact is like the perfect place for Naomi. Like, it is the perfect level for Naomi, and for her to be like, the like, one of, if not the top star of the division. Dustin Rhodes as well. He left AEW in July of this year. I think that may be fleet under our radars, but he's been hired by Impact and Iron. Yeah. The newest boys on the block hired Dustin Rhodes, and considering they are like a southern wrestling company, that is perfect, absolutely perfect person to go to there. So yeah, that's really cool. But that is not the last signing I want to discuss. Ronda Rousey is going to AEW. Yes, if you remember a while ago, we did discuss her going to Pro Wrestling Guerrilla. Because either she had no contract or was released from her contract with WWE in the Notorious Universe, and AEW have signed her to an exclusive deal. Has she won the title yet? Not yet, but give it time and she will win that title, I guarantee it. And just the last few news articles, it's not here, but I did get the financial warning email for MLW, currently sitting 92k in debt. I'm not too surprised by this. It's a shame, because if I wanted an American partner, I was kind of aiming for MLW, but they have these big names like Cody, who's on probably crazy money. AJ Styles, he's on crazy money. Can I see their contracts? LA Park, who is not even like a major star for them, is on $2,800 a show. AJ Styles, $2,600 a show. Mil Muertes, who's a face. What? Again, not even their biggest star, on $2,000 a show. All their major stars are not being paid a good amount of money. And then there's these one or two, like Laredo Kid, who's unimportant. Loretto Kid is unimportant. He's on over $1,000 a show. What are you doing? And the final bit of news is that CZW has closed its doors. Yes, another one bites the dust. Our second closure of this game. Also another American company. That's a shame to see. I'm not a massive fan of hardcore wrestling, but CZW is like, I don't even know how to describe it. Like a staple of like backyard wrestling. Like, it's been around since 1999. It's really sad to see that happen. Like 30 years ish. That's kind of crazy. But well, guys, that is all of the news and what you've missed covered. There was a lot. Holy crap, there was a lot. I was actually going to kind of cover storylines now, but I'm going to leave that because I feel like this episode is going to be long enough. So, with all that guff out of the way, let's book the show, shall we? Okay, and we are back, coming at you from the Bright Helm Centre in Brighton. It is Thursday Night Wanted. Had to move one angle onto the pre-show, which is pretty much just a duplicate of the final angle of the show. So, let's start the show. In a backstage angle, Gresham asks Lyco's Jim and Ozzy Open to sort their shit out, and Lyco's Jim admit to being jealous of the attention Ozzy Open got when they first arrived at NPW. Ozzy Open state that that doesn't make things right between them. 50 rated segment. In another pre-show backstage angle, Rey Fénix is searching for Sonico when he bumps into Jake the Snake Roberts and wants to fight Sonico, not Jake the Snake Roberts. Jake says, what does he expect, that he has come back? Jake says that Sonico and Penta used to be brothers, so there's obviously jealousy now that Pentagon's blood brother has arrived. 60 rated segment. And in the pre-show main event, Lucha Bros defeated Lay Ortiz in 1434 after the LB driver. Peter had a 44, Lucas had a 48, Penta a 66, and Ray a 76. Ray, head and shoulders above everyone else. 66 rated match overall. And on to the main show then. In a good bout, Sonico defeated Aguila Roja. Yes, we called him up from Rev Pro to get squashed and attacked by Sonico. 35 from Aguila Roja and 57 from Sonico. 52 rated overall, which is good. Post-match then, Sonico has to be forcibly removed from Aguila Roja. after a vicious assault. Yeah, so we call it McWillow because Sonico's thing at the minute is just attacking masked wrestlers. This was originally supposed to be as Zenza Volto, but unfortunately he couldn't be called up this week. Next up, in a bout that had great heat and good wrestling, Maki Ito defeated Debbie Keitel in 14:55 with a DDT. Debbie of 48, Maki of 56, 54 overall. Debbie is definitely needs a bit of work. 48 is kind of where I'm considering her mid-card at. But she has come a long way since she was, you know, used to be our jobber for the women's division. So I think I'm going to use her a bit more in Rev Pro. She does have a contract down there, so yeah, hopefully that work in Rev Pro will increase her in-ring performance. And post-match, Maiko Satomura comes out and tells Maki she needs to take this seriously, otherwise she will hurt her, and starts to anger Maki Ito. But instead of lashing out at Maiko, Maki turns around and headbutts Debbie Keitel, who is still in the ring, and shoulder barges past Maiko Satomura. 83, wow! In a backstage promo then, Nick Aldis says it's good to see Easton Reese has fallen in line and knows his place. And as him and the grizzled young vets walk away, Coach Doug is seen there and calls Reese pathetic. He was the man that tried to end his career and now he's been reduced to a henchman. 58 overall. Next up in six-man action, British Wrestling Embassy defeat Nick Aldis and the grizzled young vets when Easton Reese accidentally, there's air quotations here, if I'm not making that obvious, spears Nick Aldis, allowing Miles Kamen to get the win. Miles at 58, Thomas at 47, Mark at 47, James Drake at 60, Zach Gibson at 62, Nick Aldis at 63. 61 overall. So this will lead to Reese versus Aldis, and then my plan is for the P12, which will start up in January, we're going to introduce a mid-card title. And Easton Reese will be a part of that tournament. And then he might win it. I haven't decided yet. Pretty much Nick Aldis will beat Easton Reese. Reese will then kind of go into the tournament. And I think I might have Nick Aldis help him win it, because he kind of realizes that beating him and berating him isn't helping, and that maybe, you know, being nice to him might actually help instead. And in our main event, in an absolute clusterfuck of a main event, Aussie Open, Lycos Gym, and Jonathan Gresham defeat the Filthy Generation and the NIC. Gresham had a 54. I imagine that's because the match aim was Wild Brawl, so unfortunately that really hindered his performance. Lycos Gym, 47. Kidlikos Jr. 47, Senior 47, Fletcher 47, Mark Davies 66, Stevie Boy 53, Gervin 39, Carter 47, Oshin 47, Aspen 47. Yeah, not great performances. The Wild Brawl really hindered everyone's performance there. 54, so we'll need to be careful. Hopefully Maki Ito's promo will lift us a bit there. And to close the show, during that match then, Lycos Gym would have kind of thrown themselves in front of the bullet for Aussie Open, thus turning them face, which we're going to do now. So Lycos Gym are back to being face, and them, and Lycos Gym, and Aussie Open, and Jonathan Gresham all celebrate together, reuniting CCK, and maybe Schadenfreude. I haven't decided yet. All in all, 61, that is okay, considering we had a very poor main event for our standard, so I will happily take a 61. And there is no news then to discuss coming out of the Wanted show. So that is it for this week. Next time you guys will be back will be the Braveheart pay-per-view, where we will have Crazy Mary Dobson versus Martina in a hardcore match, Rey Fénix versus Sonico, Ace Austin versus Mark Haskins, Kings of the North versus Aussie Open for the tag titles, Maiko Satomura versus Maki Ito for the women's championship, and of course in the main event, Pac versus Pentagon Jr. for NPW title, and of course the return of the Braveheart Battle Royale, in case I haven't said that already. If you have any ideas for feuds, tag teams, stables, anything of that sort, please put them in the comments below and I'll try book that for you. With all that being said, I will see you next time on Bash Bros.